Hello everyone, it is a pleasure to welcome you all to MSB lecture series on transmetal chemistry. This is the last but one lecture. So, in this lecture let me give little bit information about few multinuclear NMR spectra and how to interpret the spectra, and also brief information about IR spectroscopy. So, in my next lecture I shall try to conclude and summarize whatever the 59 lectures I gave covering most of the aspects revolving around coordination compounds and to an extent organometallic compounds. So, now I have given a few molecules here, sketch the 19F NMR spectrum of PF5. If a question like this is asked, one thing you should know, if the information is not given about the dynamic process, or it is not given information, or it does not have any information whether the molecule is static or dynamic with fractionality, and of course PF5 is known for switching their equatorial and axial PF bonds via Berry pseudo rotation. But however, if the question does not explicitly say about the molecule, we should understand that fractionality is there in it. In that case what happens, all 5 will look almost identical with respect to NMR time scale. As a result, what happens, if you look into 19F NMR spectrum, it should show simply a doublet. All 5 will be equivalent, they will be coupled with one phosphorus. In my previous lecture, I was telling about remembering N plus 1 rule to identify number of lines in a splitting pattern. But I would say instead of this one, it is better if you use 2Ni plus 1 rule. I is the nuclear spin of the interacting nucleus, and also N is number of equivalent nuclei. For example, if CH3, CH2, OH is there, and if want to know, of course, you just leave this one. If you consider CH3, how it is splitting this one, so here 2 into 3 into half plus 1, it goes 4 lines. So, this will give 4 lines for this one, so it looks like this, and then for this one, it is 2 into 2 into half plus 1 equals 3. So, this will give 3. So, I think this is better, go with this one. This one would tell you the number of lines, the splitting pattern irrespective of number of equivalent nuclei, and also the type of nucleus we are using, whether I equals half, I equals 3 by 2, it is applicable for all type of nuclei, and also better to use this one rather than using this one, do not use this one. Okay, now let us look into, so 19F NMR would show a doublet, but on the other hand you should remember, if they are assuming it is a static molecule, in that case what happens, 2 axial are different from 3 in the plane. So that means first axial will split by PF coupling to give a doublet, and then doublet each line will be split into a quartet because of 3 in the plane. On the other hand, 3 in the plane would first split by phosphorus to a doublet, and each line in the doublet will be split into a triplet because of this one. So, if time permits I shall tell you about that one, but you should be able to work out. So, now we have this molecule is here, and of course, this is NMR active. Now, the question is asked about this one. So, 195 platinum, when the question is asked, you should not worry about abundance, because we are looking into the NMR nuclei that itself. So, in this case now we have to see, this platinum is one bond apart from P1 and two bond apart from P2. Now, first it will be split into a doublet, and then each line will be further split into a doublet. So, this coupling would say, this is for 195 PT platinum. So, this would say 1J PT P1, and then this one or this one would say 2J PT P2. So, that means spectrum would look like something like this. For this one I have given in the next slide. So, you can see here, and of course, this is how it looks, you know, 195 platinum NMR. And if you just look into this molecule here, we have 2 phosphorus, one is trivalent, one is pentavalent. So, they are magnetically and chemically non-equivalent. So, they couple each other with a large coupling constant. And now, we have selenium is there, and this selenium will couple to this one as well, this one. But if the selenium NMR is asked here, then you can see here, these are the possible isotopes, out of which only one is NMR active, 77 selenium, I equals half. That means out of 100 molecules, if you consider, out of that one 77.65, let us say 7 molecules are NMR active, remaining 63 are NMR inactive. That means basically, but when we look into 77 NMR, you have to consider it's very similar to here. So now first this one will be coupled with this one, this is something like this, and then each will be split by this second, this due to 2J selenium phosphorus coupling, and this is how the spectrum would look like. This coupling is this one, and this coupling or this coupling is 1JPSC. So this is how you should be able to write for other nucleus. But only thing is, when I am looking into 31P NMR, if I look into 31P NMR of this one, we have two signals in this case. First, let us say this one is coupled with this one, it gives a doublet. This is due to 1J PP coupling. If I put P1 and P2, and now P1 will be coupled with this small coupling will be there. Okay, so this is your 2J PSC coupling, 2J PSC coupling, this one also. So it looks like, and other one, now this one also will show very similar to that one, but it may show larger coupling. So now how it looks like, the first this is coupled with, so now it is not 100%. As a result, what would happen is, first you get something like this, a doublet, and each doublet will be further split into small. This one will be something like this, and this will be something like this. So this is your PSC coupling. But when you take this one, it will also show a doublet, but here it will show a larger coupling. So larger coupling, how it shows? Something like this. Depending upon how much selenium-selenium coupling, it would be splitting like this. So you should see that one. I will show you a few more examples. Now let us look into this molecule here. So here we have two phosphorus, one is bonded directly to rhodium, other one is two bond apart. Now let us look into first A here. First this one will be coupled with rhodium, this rhodium coupling is larger, 103 rhodium is I equals half and 100% abundant. So first you get a line like this, and then this is your 1J rhodium phosphorus coupling. Rhodium phosphorus coupling, and now this will be further split by this one to triplet. This should triplet because PF coupling. So each one, this is your PF coupling triplet, and now this each line will be split into a doublet because of 1 to 2J PP coupling. So now it looks like that. So basically a doublet, a triplet, and a triplet, each line will be a doublet. So that means a doublet of triplets, doublet of triplets of doublet. So this is how it is, doublet of triplets of doublets, doublet of triplets of doublets. This is how you mention the spectrum. In the same way, if you go for PB here, first this will be coupled with say rhodium phosphorus 2J coupling will be there, or if PP coupling is more, that would be there. Here PP coupling would be more here, so 2J PP coupling, this one will be little less, and this is your 2J rhodium phosphorus coupling, and then this will be further split by fluorine on this one. So this smaller coupling, then this is called doublet of doublets of triplets. Okay, you should be able to distinguish and interpret properly. So first phosphorus, if you consider this one, this is coupled with rhodium because the coupling is larger, about 250 hertz, and then each line of this one, a doublet, will be split by triplet because of PF coupling. PF coupling will be less in magnitude compared to rhodium phosphorus 1J coupling, and then each line will be further split into PP coupling. So this is how you can see the coupling tree. You can write like this, then one can write a spectrum like this. So two are there, doublet of triplets of doublets. So now when you consider this molecule here, simply if somebody asks you to sketch 14 in NMR for this one, we have three options. Okay, three options are there. What are those? If you see, this hydrogen is one bond apart, these two phosphorus are one bond apart. You do not know the magnitude of NP coupling and NH coupling. So in this case, we have to see whether PN coupling can be larger than NH coupling, one case, or PN coupling will be smaller than NH coupling, or both of them can be identical. In that case, first let us look into PN coupling is larger. First, in that case, what happens? It will first triplet into a triplet, because P n coupling is larger triplet, and then each one will be split into a doublet like this. So, this is one. Second option is a P n coupling is smaller than NH coupling. NH coupling is then it will first give a doublet due to NH coupling, and then each one will be split into triplet 1:2:1. So, the spectrum will be something like this, and in this case it will be, in the third case both are identical, the magnitude is, so that means basically this is interacting with three identical nuclei although they are of different elements. So, now how to say, again use 2ni+1 rule, I equals half here. So, 2 into, so 3 are there, 3 into half 4 lines. So, what you get is 4 lines in third case. So, first it will split into something like this, then it will be 1:3:3:1. So, these 3 conditions are there, and you should see what condition matches which one, you should know. Now, let us look into the most common question we come across about boron hydride, sodium borohydride if you take, anion here BH4 anion. So, the spectrum is shown here, this is 1H NMR spectrum. Now, we have to explain why these lines are, 4 lines are equivalent, and also we have some lines here. Now, you should remember boron consists of 2 isotopes, 10 boron with I equals 3 and then 11 boron I equals 3/2. So, now you should see if 2ni+1 rule you should apply for this one, this is 80%, that means out of 100 molecules, 80 molecules have 11 boron and 20 molecules have 10 boron. So, first we should write for 80, now 2 into only 1 boron is there, but spin is 3/2+1. So, you should give 4 lines of equal intensity, something like this. So, this is for 10, 11 boron H coupling. 4 lines, and this separation is identical, this is approximately 80 hertz, this is equals 80 hertz. Now, you should remember, now we have 20%, if this is 80%, then 20% intensity will be for this one, 20 molecules, they have 10 boron, if 10 boron I equals 3, so 2 into only 1 boron is there, 1:3+1, so here it is 7, so there should be 7 lines, these 7 lines you can see here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, they will be essentially 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, something like this, and then each separation is identical, this separation is 10 boron H coupling. So, this is how you can interpret, and you can also explain why the smaller lines are this. It is overlapping of both, because when you look into boron NMR, it will account for 10 boron as well as 11 boron, 11 boron out of 100 molecules, molecules with 11 boron are 80, and 10 boron are 20. So, if you look into intensity of this one, if it is 80, say each one is 20 intensity, and then here 10 means 10/6, you can see how much it is, about 1.5 intensity or something, at the end both of them should be match 100%. So, this is how one can interpret. Now, one more question, the element lead has several naturally occurring isotopes including all these things. Of these isotopes, only 207 has a non-zero nuclear spin I equals half. What would you expect to observe for 1H NMR spectrum of tetramethyl lead, okay, given the 2J coupling is 60 hertz. So, then how do you explain this one? The question is very simple, we have given here. So, now it is 1H NMR spectrum. So, that means, if you just look into all isotopes except for 22% is NMR active I equals half. Other you can consider 78% NMR I equals, you can ignore. So, that means basically we have 100 molecules, 22 molecules have I equals half, 207 lead, others are, we should not worry. That means those 78% will first show a singlet, and then these 22% what happens, this will be split into doublet, and then like equidistance from this one, these are called satellite peaks, these are. And now it is, this is 11%, this is 11%, this will be 78% if you look into the intensity. And now this separation is called 1JPBH coupling, this is equal to 60 hertz. So, this is what given, something like this, this is how the spectrum looks like. So, now let us look into this one, this is very interesting. First let me write 31P NMR, and let me write the structure of the molecule quickly, N, and remember this is 15N, is 100%, it is 15N. So now SI we H, this is something like this, all are in NMR active. So something like this. This one is strongly coupled with 2 fluorine atoms. First it should give a triplet. So let me write little bigger because lot of coupling is going to come here. So triplet, this is your PF coupling, same triplet, and now this is coupled with N, a doublet. So doublet, each one is a doublet. This is done, this is your PN coupling. Now this H coupling, so H coupling will come, another doublet. Doublet, this is your NH coupling, and now these 3 are there, these 3 will also couple, each one will be split into a quadrat. And intensity will be 1:3:3:1. So you should be able to sketch this spectrum beautifully. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 12 into 2, 48 lines will be there totally. So then you can say triplet of doublets of quadrets. This is how the NMR would look like. You can see here, this is how it looks like, and this is how you can interpret and do it. Try for 15N, also 1H NMR also you should try. This is very interesting, just look into this molecule here, this PPR far away. And then if you see here, it will show single peak for both the phosphorus atom, one is on nitrogen, one is on oxygen. They do not have any coupling because they are far away from each other. But in the complex, now they are 2 bond apart because of platinum chelation, now they can show PP coupling. Now this small separation is PP coupling, and now platinum again, if you consider platinum, 34% of platinum is NMR active, I equals half, that is 195 platinum. Rest is 66 is we should not worry, and 0, 196 platinum. So that means basically if I have 100 molecules, so each one would show a doublet PP coupling, this also shows a doublet. Now they will show satellite peak due to this one, each intensity will be 17%. So this one you can see, this is 1 and this is 1. So here this is separation, this separation, or this separation is identical, this is for this PT coupling and this one and this one for this PT coupling. So this is satellite peaks are there, and if you just look into this one, this is 17% and then this is 17% and then this is 66%. So this is how you can write satellite peaks equidistant from the central one, that is for I equals 0 species isotope. So this is how you can see, and the magnitude I have given, the 1J PTP coupling is very large when they are cis, 4000 to it can go even up to 6 to 7000, and usually when 2 phosphorus are trans to each other, PTP coupling will be less than 2000 hertz, or it may be 2400. That means if any isomerization is there, or if you have cis compound or trans compound, you should be able to tell immediately simply by looking into phosphorus platinum coupling. So now here for example, this compound is taken, bis triphenyl phosphine ruthenium CpCl. This compound was prepared using, I showed you the method, and when it is reacted with a bisphosphine, all possible, so we got all the products as a mixture. And how to assign this one? Well, simply 31P NMR can tell you what are the products you have in the mixture. So for example, this will show a singlet, whereas this one show a doublet for these 2. And a triplet for this one, and then this would show a doublet for this one, and these 2 will couple with this one, it shows a triplet, and then this would show a triplet, and each triplet line will be split into a doublet. And then if you look into the intensity, you can also get the information in what ratios these compounds were made, and also if you know the reaction condition, whether in case if there is a problem in separating these 3, we should think of separate reaction method for isolation of these compounds by looking into the stoichiometry and reaction condition. For example, here RuCl bond is broken, that means the yields of this compound can be enhanced by using a polar solvent. Whereas if you use non-polar solvent, you can retain RuCl bond and simply you can replace 2 triphenyl phosphine with a chelate ligand. Here what happens, entropy is the driving force for this one, so that you can analyze using spectrum and also you can understand the reaction condition, and accordingly you can change the reaction condition to make the desired compounds. I will show you the spectrum here. This is how the mixture looks like. The one compound where we have simple chelation or are identical one you are getting, as I mentioned here, you have very nicely you can interpret the data for three type of compounds we have. This one will show a singlet, and this will show a complicated, three lines are there, one, and then this will show a doublet and a triplet, these two, and whereas this one is a doublet for this one, and then this is a doublet of doublet here, and then this one show a triplet and each triplet line is split into doublet. So you can very nicely interpret and understand what kind of products you got in your own reaction. And now if you just look into N-butyl lithium, it has a cubane structure. For example, two spectra are given at 195 K, okay, it is static structure. Here three lithiums are connected to each carbon, cubane structure is there. Just recall my teaching in my main group chemistry lecture, if you have looked into, or you can just go to my lectures and look into it, the structure. So three lithiums are connected to tertiary carbon here. So this one will show seven lines here, because lithium has I equals 1. So if you use 3Ni plus 1, 3 into 2 plus 1, 7 lines it shows. But on the other hand, when the fluxional process is there, we have 4 equivalent lithiums are there in cubane, 4 alternate carbons are occupied by lithium and methyl group. So we have totally 4 lithium atoms are there, all are interacting with carbon because of fluxional process. In that case we get 9 lines. So very nicely you can interpret the data. So this is about, similarly you can look into this one, and you can just see, I will stop now. I shall proceed for IR spectroscopy for few minutes. So infrared spectroscopy is a vital tool to chemists wishing to identify what functional groups exist in unknown samples. The light our eyes see is but a small part of a broad spectrum of electromagnetic radiation in the visible region. On the immediate high energy side of the visible spectrum lies the ultraviolet, and on the low energy side is the infrared one. So you can see here, this is the range. So with a wavelength range of 2500 to 16,000 nanometer, the infrared region is capable of revealing information not easily uncovered through basic means. And what are those things? So proton energies associated with the infrared region are not large enough to excite electrons, but they are still strong enough to induce vibrational excitation of covalently bonded atoms and groups. So when you look into a bond, so covalent bonds are not rigid sticks, but rods, but are like spring that can be rotated if the single bond is there, or they can be stretched like this, or they can be bent. This is how, with by simply absorbing energy in the infrared region, this will be, the stretching is there, bending is there, all rotation is there. So this wide variety of vibrational motions is characteristic to a molecule's component atoms. All organic and inorganic compounds will absorb infrared radiation that corresponds in energy to these vibrations, and infrared spectrometers permit chemists to obtain absorption spectra of compounds that are a unique reflections of their molecular structure. So now let us look into a typical spectrum I have given here, and this is for formaldehyde. So IR readings are inverted compared with UV visible spectra. UV spectra you can see like this is coming, but it looks like inverted one with sharp peaks, while that one that did absorb, a significant amount would be towards the bottom. If they are absorbing, they will be falling down. Those do not absorb will go flat like that. Each peak dips on the graph represents various bond characteristics, and because most functional groups have specific bonds, they can be readily identified. I have given the groups and also corresponding stretching frequency here. Formaldehyde, what is important is ketone carbonyl group is there and shows around 1750 centimeter minus. So this how, this is the inverse one, we are not considering this one. So this how it looks like. So now how it helps, it is very very important in carbonyl complexes, infrared, and it is very vital in structural determination also, by simply looking into the number of bands in the CO stretching region. If the number is consistent with that provided by the selection rule of a particular point group, may be assigned to that molecule. And also for CO, around 2000 centimeter inverse is very, very important. Relationship between the molecular structure of a compound and the activity of stretching modes can also be understood and analyzed to arrive at the structure of a molecule. For substituted carbonyl complexes, we can think of assigning point groups, considering the local symmetry of the metal and the carbonyl groups, provided ligands have spherical symmetry, or by considering the symmetry of the molecule as a whole. So, we have two options before we assign. Look into stretching frequencies. For example, let us look into example shown here, CpMnCO3, it has C3V symmetry, and CpVCO4, it has C4V symmetry. And if you just look into this one, arene MCO3, it has again C3V symmetry. So, all of them show two stretching frequencies for carbon monoxide. And both Cp and C6H6 arene are axially symmetrical with respect to these point groups. That means you can rotate through that one, okay. Passing through the middle of your Cp group or benzene, you can do a rotation. And in case if we replace arene group with say aniline or something or thiophene, what happens? Symmetry will be lowered, then the symmetry of whole molecule has to be considered. So, you should not consider local symmetry of metal, you have to consider the whole symmetry. In that case, what happens? We will see three stretching frequencies. Electron distribution, okay, of course, electron distribution I have discussed in length, how a pair of electrons on carbon will go to metal through sigma bonding, and metal T2g electrons will be transferred to pi star through back bonding. So, depending upon to what extent electrons are moving from metal to ligand, stretching frequency will vary accordingly. So, this is the typical bond explanation. So, this is sigma bonding and this is pi bonding. These two modes of bonding are mutually reinforcing and strengthening metal to carbon bond. This is called synergy effect or synergistic effect. Charge removal through pi bonding leads to more extensive sigma bonding, while charge donated through sigma bonding thus facilitates further back bonding. So, that means it is give and take. Because of sigma donation, you see, carbonyl become electron deficient and metal become rich, it gives through back bonding. With back bonding, what happens? Metal become poor and carbon monoxide become rich. So, sigma bonding will be stronger. So, both of these opposite direction bonding strengthens each other. As a result, what happens? We call it as synergistic effect. So, eventually metal to carbon bond is strengthened and carbon to oxygen bond is weakened. So, to what extent this is weakened or strengthened depending upon how much electrons are coming from metal to pi star of carbon monoxide. So, that is a measure of the overall electron density at the metal center. And if you are looking into the combined or mixed ligand complexes, what is the share of other backbonding ligands and how they compare in terms of their backbonding capabilities. For example, while it is not necessary to remember all of the peaks for each functional group, learning a few key characteristics will be enough to answer 99% of all IR questions. In the reading of formaldehyde spectrum, we have a lot of peaks here. We should not focus on those things. We have to focus on only few things like CO stretching, where it is, and also whether we have CH3 or stretching or any other. So, these are very important while characterizing. This we call it as fingerprint region. So, the complexity of infrared spectra in the 1450 and to 600 centimeter region makes it very difficult. We get lot of peaks in this region. It is difficult to assign all the absorption bands, and because of unique pattern found there, it is often called the fingerprint region. It is not necessary to remember any peaks in this region, as they will not help you determine any significant functional groups, and not any significant functional groups come in that region either. So, absorption bands in the 4000 to 1450 are important, are usually due to stretching vibrations of diatomic units, and this is sometimes called the group frequency region. It is this region which is most practical to identifying groups. Some notable frequencies that should be remembered I have shown here. You can see alcohols and acids, OH group is there, in this range it is there. For amines, NH, this will be this range, and for alkanes, CH, okay, they come here, narrow peak, and ketones, acids, CO group will be here, and for triple bonds, CCRCN, it will be important. If acetonitrile binding is there or acetylene binding is there, these are very important. So, one thing to keep in mind about IR spectra is that it can only tell you whether a group is present or not. It will not tell you how many groups or how large the molecule is. One should remember, it is just qualitative, not quantitative. For example, if you see a sharp peak at 17 50 centimeter minus 1, it will tell us that there is some sort of a carbonyl group. It can be ketone, ester, or part of an acid, etc. Or sometime it can be metal carbon monoxide with extensive back bonding, or it may be bridging two metal centers, but it will not tell us perhaps there are 2 or 3 ketone groups present. So, it will not tell you whether how many such groups are present. As I mentioned, it is qualitative, not quantitative. With this in mind and using only the selected few important peaks, we have to remember. So, we can say easily, or we can guess what functional groups are present and thus identify the molecules from a few selections. In the following spectrum, if you see, we should focus our attention on 3000 and 1750. One can most easily notice a sharp peak around 1700 easily. So, that means you can conclude that there is a CO group, thus it is most likely a ketone or aldehyde. This range also tells you. Secondly, there is no broad group or a sharp group around 3000. So, that means there is no OH or NH. So, there is however a sharp peak just below 3000, which most likely corresponds to alkane CH, CH2 and or CH3 bonds. It could be part of the aldehydic CH bond as well. So, that means if the choices are there like 2-methylcyclobutanol, 3-methyl-2-butanone and 2-chloropentanoic acid, if the options are these, it should be very clear that we will recognize this as 3-methyl-2-butanone, which has both necessary CO band and it lacks a OH bond as well. So, immediately you can pick the right one among these three to say that this spectrum belongs to this molecule here. It's easy. So, now let us look into metal carbonyls. Metal carbonyls with nitrogen donors, you can make a maximum, you can replace a maximum of 3 carbonyls I mentioned. So, now if you see here, free carbon monoxide is around 2133 and metal hexacarbonyls will show around 2000, and increase in negative charge on metal is observed by new CO changes. For example, you can see here. So, it is a positive charge is there and it is here neutral and its negative charge is there. So, when your negative charge is there, more electron density is there, as a result stretching frequency will drop, more electron density goes to the pi star, and here it is a midway 2000, whereas here is a positively charged. So, less electron density goes from the metal, as a result stretching frequency is more. So, we should be able to analyze the electron density that resides on metal very easily by looking into the stretching frequencies. And of course, the two extreme cases of metal carbonyls is shown here, very strengthened and very weak, and very strong here CO group, and here of course metal to carbon strength increases in this order. Okay, this information very nicely comes from IR spectroscopy. So, π-acceptor ability of CO in metal hexacarbonyls will tell you that it can take anywhere between, each carbon monoxide can take anywhere between 0.1 to 1.2 electron pairs to its pi star orbitals. So, new CO decreases as more and more groups are substituted. That means more and more groups are substituted with non-backbonding ligands. In that case, what happens? The responsibility falls on few carbon monoxide left on the metal. As a result, the stretching frequency decreases. So, complete substitution of CO from MCO6 has been achieved only with strong π-acceptor ligands such as PF3. The best competitors for CO are phosphines, especially having strong electron withdrawing groups or electronegative groups on phosphorus. So, advantage with phosphines is coordination properties can be readily altered, but you cannot do with carbon monoxide. So, among no π-acceptor ligands, so example diglyme, ammonia and all those things, if you want to know what is diglyme, it is an ether something like this, and how to spell it? You can say diethylene glycol dimethyl ether. Many reactions you come across diglyme, you should be able to write the structure and you can tell it is diethylene glycol dimethyl ether. So, mixed metal carbonyls with one or more diglyme like ligands can also show some trends in their stretching frequencies. For example, if diglyme is there, that shows higher stretching frequency than having simple di in here. And also, when we have these things, sigma orbitals for back bonding decreases, and then relative sigma donor ability of above donor atoms may be estimated from the stabilities of their addition complexes, especially with aluminum trichloride, say Lewis acid. The order of donating ability is also follows this order and this order. It is about only back bonding. This has to do nothing with stretching frequencies. So, now I have given depending upon the type of point group possessed by these molecules and how many IR active modes are there. For example, MCO5L is there, you can see 3 CO bands, and if you have something like the cis, you can see 4, and if you have trans you can see one, and you can just go through this one. I have given for octahedral geometry and I have given for trigonal bipyramidal geometry as well, and also I have mentioned position of carbon monoxide and also the point group here. Just you can look into it. And now for example, you take hexachromyl and if you replace 1, 3 and you get a facial, in that case we get only 2 provided all ligands are identical. And then in case what happens, if you have 1 MCO5L you get 3 stretching frequencies, and if you have trans we get only 1 stretching frequency. Similarly, if you have cis here we can get 4 stretching frequencies, and if you have something like this here we can get 3 stretching frequencies meridional. So something in the same way, when we go for pentachromyl and if you start replacing carbon monoxide with L, the number of stretching frequencies would be shown in this figure here. So 3 active here, 4 active are there, and in this case CS, so all of them are unique, you can see 3 different, and same thing here and same thing here. With this, so let me conclude about IR spectroscopy, NMR spectroscopy, and overall whatever I wanted to tell as a part of this course. Probably in my last lecture I should try to consolidate and sum up, and also if anything is left, little bit I will highlight about that one and conclude my lecture. So that would be the 60th lecture. So thank you for your kind attention, and I have to go through quickly in case of IR and NMR because of lack of time, of course, but everything is there in the slides, and also I have spoken already. Please listen to what I say and also try to look into all the slides in detail and try to understand the chemistry behind these things. Thank you so much.